ladies and gentlemen, I should say Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to Caulfield Institute of Technology. Of course, I'd like to give a particular welcome to the Premier, Mr. Hamer, who was with us on the dais. I particularly welcome also Dr. Law and Mrs. Law. We are pleased also to have with us Mr. and Mrs. Rafferty. Mr. Rafferty, if I might say so, has two claims to fame. Not only is he the member for Glen Huntly, the electorate in which this institute resides, but he's also a former member of council of this institute. We're also delighted to have with us the recently elected member for Higgins, another electorate in which we reside, Mr. Shipton. A group of people we're very pleased to see come from the municipalities also in which we reside and which we have neighbours. Councillor and Mrs. Taylor from Caulfield, Councillor and Mrs. Davison from Malvern, and Councillor and Mrs. Bricker from Moorabbin. We're very pleased to have you here too. Also with us, of course, on occasions like this when a new building is to be opened, we have representatives of the architectural firm who designed and supervised the building, and we have today four people from Eggleston, MacDonald and Seacombe, Mr. MacDonald, Mr. Corran, Mr. Stevens and Mr. McElraith. We're pleased to have them with us. Representatives of the builders are here. We're pleased to have Mr. Goodsell and Mr. Donovan. Also in the group, as a group, we're delighted to have some friends of the Institute, people with whom we collaborate in one way or another and who collaborate with us, and they are representatives from industry, from commerce and from public bodies. We endeavour to serve a purpose for them as Caulfield Institute of Technology, and they in their turn, we're delighted to say, are able to perform services for us in assisting us in the development of Caulfield Institute of Technology. We also have amongst the distinguished members present members of our own council and their wives. We have members of the Institute, members of staff and members of the student body, and we also have friends of the Institute in addition to those. I welcome you one and all. We're delighted to have you here. I thought it would be appropriate if I said a few words, and I think the President, perhaps, who knows me as well as any, will know that I can't resist making a few statements on occasions like this, but perhaps we could start with a few facts about Caulfield Institute of Technology for those who don't know us well enough. You may or may not know that we have, in an educational sense, six schools, four of which cover the tertiary areas, engineering, applied science, business and general studies, and two that cover the technical and further education areas. Those are the schools of orientation studies and the school of industrial studies, each of them with their own specialities. And I can't expect to cover them all, but if you consider applied science, for instance, we have unique areas of water science, we have computer science and electronic data processing generally, just to name a few. In engineering, there are specialities of computer control, navigation electronics and so on. Business has its specialities of marketing and banking. The general studies area has its special fields, and I emphasise the special field here of applied psychology and applied sociology, graphic design and similar areas of speciality. Orientation studies is a new one for us, where we are trying to provide a service for people who recently or not so recently have left first education, or their first span of education, which may or may not have been secondary education, trying to assist them to reorientate their educational progress either towards technical and further education or towards one of our tertiary schools. And the last, but by no means the least, is an area that's been longest in Caulfield Institute of Technology that we now have as a School of Industrial Studies, and they have their specialties too. And the one I think of offhand is in industrial ceramics. Now, this is just to give you a pen picture of the place. Going on to some further facts, We can say that the philosophy of the Council of the Institute and the philosophy of the Institute as a whole is that, we are endeavouring to get the best of the dollar by using the resources that we have, resources both of manpower and equipment, to use those resources most effectively. So it doesn't really worry us. In fact, it pleases us if we can use facilities for both tertiary and TAFE areas. The size of the institution you may be interested in, the count at present is something like 5,600 students all told. They roughly divide 50-50 into full-time and part-time students. If you divide them between the tertiary areas and the TAFE areas, you find that's about 80% of the students, this is in bodies I'm talking about, 80% of the students would be in tertiary courses, and the remaining 20% would be split approximately half and half, 10% each, between the School of Orientation Studies and the School of Industrial Studies. You will find, if you have the time after this meeting, you will find that just around the corner, the Premier and I just had a quick look at it, a campus plan of development of the Institute, which will show you something about what this complex that we're in is going to develop to over the next few years, we hope. What you see outside, for instance, is going to be particularly important to us, because in the ultimate development, that becomes a walkway which goes right through to Caulfield Station. And the railways permitting, Mr. Premier, we hope to have the railway, Caulfield Railway Station on our campus by having having access, direct access to it. The development then is along a spine, of which this is the walkway. Underneath there'll be vehicular traffic. The further part of the campus development that I should refer to relates to funds which have been made available to us through the Education Department for the development of an annex in Dandenong Road, some six doors from Kurnang Road in Carnegie. It's in Dandenong Road, but it's this side of Kurnang Road, where our School of Industrial Studies will divert. On a small site, we need to have the cooperation of the Education Department to move our School of Industrial Studies so that we can develop what remains. I thought I should say a few words, in fact I feel I should say a few words, about the government of tertiary education, and I'm not doing this because Dr. Law is present, but I would have done it anyway. But I think it is appropriate at this stage to say something about the government of tertiary education. And I can't say, Mr. Premier, that I'm not saying this because you are present. It is a stage, an important stage, I believe, in the development of tertiary education that we've reached. And what I'd like to say first is just what stage we are at. And I'm, of course, thinking particularly of Caulfield Institute of Technology, but not uniquely so. There is a VIC system, and Dr. Law, as you most of you will know, is vice president of that body. CIT is an affiliated college. The act that sets up the VIC gives us certain powers, and I include in those rationalisation of courses, I'll say a little bit more about that later, approval of courses, awarding of degrees. There's a similar body in Victoria called the State College of Victoria, which has somewhat similar responsibilities in relation to what were previously teachers' colleges. Then, of course, we have three, and soon to be four, universities, the fourth one being the one that's being formed at Geelong, Deakin University. We also have, that's at the state level, and remember, universities are state bodies set up by state acts. Then we have at the Australian government level a Commission on Advanced Education, and because, as from the 1st of January 1974, funding flowed through Canberra, and it was not a matching grant basis as it previously was with the states, there are inroads into the autonomy both of the VIC that I've mentioned and into the colleges, and perhaps you can say this is an unavoidable effect of the Australian government funding. Then there is another body that is somewhat similar to the Commission on Advanced Education called the Australian Universities Commission that has a somewhat similar role for the university groups. And if you look at it in terms of numbers, there's something like 85, I think, College of Advanced Education throughout Australia. There are something like 17, I think it is, universities throughout Australia, and those are the two Australian government coordinating bodies. Recently, you will have read, in fact, last year, towards the end of last year, about the setting up of a tertiary education commission. There was a report, briefly described as a Jones report, which made some recommendations, and the previous Australian government was in the process of implementing most of the recommendations of that Jones report. Since the election, the position of the Tertiary Education Commission appears to be quite unclear, and I think it's possible that the Act as it was, or the Bill as it was originally, the original form of the Bill could be changed in some respects. How, I don't know. That's the, I can call it the hierarchy of controls over institutions like CIT and similar bodies. That raises the general question of the problem of independence and rationalisation. Now, I might can say quite candidly, frankly, that I'm a strong believer in rationalisation. I believe that rationalisation of courses is essential if we're going to keep educational costs within reasonable bounds. But on the other hand, if you have rationalisation associated with too many controls, then I believe you lose the enthusiasm of people. And to me, education, it's so often been said, is a people's game, whether it's me or other members of staff of this institute, it's still a human relations activity. And in my opinion, you get maximum enthusiasm from people and organisations when there is a maximum of independence. And further, I believe that if there is this maximum of independence, then you tend to get a maximum sense of responsibility, particularly when it comes to the spending of scarce resources. Now, within these constraints, I believe in rationalisation, which is a constraint, a real constraint, and my belief that there should be maximum independence, I think there is room for change. Another relevant point at present is that the VIC colleges, the SCV colleges, and I think there's something like 27 or 8 in total, and the universities have increasing conflicts of interest. I'm on the rationalisation thing again. There's very little effective rationalisation taking place across those systems, and if I can introduce a further area where there is going to be need for rationalisation, technical and further education, where the upper limits of one, and you know, whether it's upper or lower is just a matter of verbiage, but let's use those terms, the upper ends of one and the lower ends of the other, and we won't define which is which, impinge, and there are grey areas. There is reason here for some further rationalisation. Now that makes me introduce the idea that perhaps at this stage, after there has been an existence, the VIC, for a little over 10 years now, a time for change in organisation. There is a time, there's a possibility of change because there is a bill to go before Parliament, the Australian Government, in the near future, that gives an opportunity for a rethink of the controls in terms of rationalisation across the areas that I've mentioned and in terms of the independence that I've also mentioned. I think myself that Victoria needs some organisation, I'm not going to define it, needs some organisation which looks at and has some powers over rationalisation of courses over the areas I've mentioned, and also the total growth of tertiary educational opportunity in Victoria. I also believe that Australia, that means the Australian government, needs an organisation to provide equal opportunity between the states and to determine the appropriate funding levels if the Commonwealth government is to continue funding. The CAEs, coming lower down the scale, need a greater degree of independence in course details and the granting of awards, in my opinion. Now, I believe this is the time we should be thinking and making our feelings known on these matters. Now, I've told you something about Caulfield Institute of Technology. I've told you something about tertiary education, as I see it, very briefly. Now, something about this particular building. If you look in your program, you will find a summary of the usage that this building is being given. You'll find there are some sections of the School of Engineering housed in this building, You will read the level, particular levels that they occupy. You'll find there are some areas of the School of General Studies that occupy this building, including the Art Department. You will find some of the work of the Art Department scattered around this particular area. I hope that you will take the opportunity, either today if you have time or some other time when you feel like coming back, to look over the building and just see what the facilities are. Now, I have two things I want to say in conclusion. We're delighted to have with us one gentleman I did not introduce earlier because I wish to give him very, very special mention. We have with us today, I haven't seen him, but I was told he was coming, Mr. Stevens, who happened to be one of the foundation members of council of this institution when it was Caulfield Technical School. Now, Caulfield Technical School started as a gleam in the eye of a few people around about 1919. It came as an organisation in 1922, and we're delighted to have with us a foundation member of the council in 1922, and the man who was treasurer for some years, Mr. Stevens. I'd like you to give him a very, very special welcome. Finally, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the president of Caulfield Institute of Technology Council, Mr. Watson.
Mr. Premier, Dr. Law, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. Director. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you know why Hartley's nickname is Mr. Well Said. You know, I was reminded a few moments ago that we tend to get too absorbed with formality in such a presentation as we're having this afternoon. Surely, it's a great occasion. It's a great occasion for Caulfield. But we've got to remember, perhaps, that it's a festive occasion. We're celebrating something. We've got something to celebrate, haven't we? It's something to feel good about. It's something to feel good about for CIT. That's both for students and for staff. It's something to celebrate for the whole of the Caulfield community and for business and industry that this institute services. I suppose it's fair to say that the activity this afternoon spotlights the responsibilities that we all share. And it's great to see so many friends along in support of us in an activity like this, because the responsibilities we share are to see that all the ingredients that are required to achieve maximum benefit from a college like this are fostered, are balanced, are supported, and are managed in a way that we will get these benefits, that places like this that have been built with foresight and with energy and with courage deserve. We have a responsibility, surely, to ensure that the overall operations and the continued development of Caulfield Institute of Technology occurs in harmony with the community. That's no easy task, is it, when you think about it? You know, you might say, what's involved in the development in harmony with the community? Well, as our director has indicated, the primary group concerned with that development has to be the student body. After all, that's what we're about here, isn't it? They don't let us forget that, and that's good news. We don't want them to let us forget. Our task, you might say, our joint task, is to maintain a climate that will help students grow both as individuals and as members of society in a way that will cause them to proact rather than to react to the needs of their time. You'll be happy to hear, and I want to tell you I'm very glad to be able to do so, that the student bodies here display real initiative and a high sense of responsibility in the activities around Caulfield Institute. Sir, the elections for students occur in a couple of weeks' time. I might have a comment to make on that a little later. Talking about this togetherness, this operating together, this cooperation, we've recently established here a community centre with a board of management to assist further interaction between students and staff and council. And that body are working away at their objectives and the processes that will allow them to bring the qualities of life that we want in this place. Speaking of being representative, the college is very conscious of the need both to maintain and extend its contact with the community. You know, listening to Hartley a moment ago, we're reminded of the scope of education that this college offers. I was searching around recently for a definition of education. Naturally, I could have asked an educator, but you know, that to an industrialist mightn't be the thing to do. Then I looked at a second-hand dictionary, and that didn't seem to help me. But I did happen on an old adage that said, education is man's going forward from cocksure ignorance to thoughtful uncertainty. I want to tell you that anybody here at the college who feels cocksure is certainly ignorant. But, for instance, the sort of contact that we need to maintain, our council membership is designed in large part with that influence in mind. Many walks of life, many areas of the community, both inside and outside the college, are represented on that council. Now, in any complex organisation, you know, we are inclined to get involved in our own thing, aren't we? We're inclined to look inwards and become insular. And that's something that we are very concerned about, that we avoid that isolation. Fortunately, I suppose we could say that the vocational emphasis in this place, and when you think about it, we cover anything from pattern making to pottery, from data processing to psychology. There's a tremendous range of vocational interests here. And that requires us to be in close touch with business and with industry, with employers, if you like, and with employing agencies. And if you have a look at the courses that are operating here, and perhaps even more deeply, to the student projects that shows the way in which real problems are used in learning techniques, then I think we realise that that contact is working. We've got to keep fostering it, but it's there. On the other hand, we're conscious that CIT's expertise and the facilities, part of what we're about today, should be readily available to companies and community groups. Here we have a community involvement committee working. That committee was set up with just this thought in mind of helping us get out and interact with the various groups around us, our neighbours. I don't want you to think that CIT, sir, is without its problems. It's not. Many of us who live around here realise that one of them is parking. And I can see one or two mayors nodding very knowingly at that problem. This is naturally a small, well-built-up campus with a large, mobile group of people coming and going. There's a representative of General Motors Holdens. I'm very happy to see them come and go in motor cars, sir. But we need to be taking care of some parking difficulties. and we have been working with councils and with state authorities towards such a solution. Another difficulty is, at the moment, the acquisition of properties that we need that are, in fact, already identified for campus growth and development. The acquisition of these properties at the moment is delayed because of inadequate funds, and some of the vendors in this situation are being disadvantaged. One immediate problem that's conscious in many of our minds today is the fluctuating student demand, coupled with a tight, and I might say a tighter, budget, and this affects staff utilisation and career planning, and we're looking for new solutions in these areas. All these issues require cooperation, don't they? And we've been fortunate. We've enjoyed cooperation of the highest order from all the authorities concerned. I just was accosted a moment ago by two very shapely young ladies. I want to say it's not very often that a president is accosted, well, not often enough, a president is accosted by two shapely young ladies. But they brought us the good news, Mr. Premier, that our child care centre has just received some funds. That advice just came through today, and if you'd have seen the joy on the faces of those girls who are working quite hard in this area, you'd have been thrilled to bits. Now, speaking of support, I know that you would want me to congratulate all those concerned with the erection of the Phillip Law Building, the planners, the architects, the builders, our own building officer, Ken Raverty, the building committee under the chairmanship of George Walmsley. They have done a wonderful job, and gentlemen, we want to thank you for that. Now, I know that you're all very keen this afternoon to be left in good hands. But before I do that, I'd just like to go back to this matter of election, sir, and to try and dispel two rumours that I've heard about the campus. It's not true, ladies and gentlemen, that the Premier is here today as a consultant to the student body to help them with their elections. He says behind me quietly, they can help him, but that's the other rumour. That's the other rumour I wanted to dispel, that in fact he's not here to take some of their policies back ready for Saturday. Well, as you know, the man you're waiting to hear from has a tremendous record of service to the people of Victoria. A solicitor, a Member of Parliament since 1958, he saw action with the AOF in the Middle East, Tobruk, and the Pacific. He's a former member of the Council of Melbourne University, a former vice president, indeed, of Swinburne College of Technology. He's a family man with two sons and two daughters. And when time allows, he enjoys sailing, tennis, and golf. Ladies and gentlemen, let us give the Premier a real Caulfield Institute welcome. Mr. Hamer.
Mr. President, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Minister, Mr. Shipton, ladies and gentlemen. As you've heard, I'm a kind of renegade from Swinburne Tech. I was there for 23 years on the council and as vice president. And I can't tell you how much pleasure it gives me to come to a sister institution like Caulfield and see the initiation of this fine new building. I was reluctant to retire from Swinburne, I just had to, because on the council we used to spend a fair bit of time devising ways and means and ploys and gambits for approaching the state treasurer for more funds. And I foresaw some problems about going into that operation and then receiving the deputation at the other end. But I only mention it for this reason, that I am personally very committed to the whole idea and cause of technical education in this state. I think that Victoria has a lot to give credit to previous administrations and previous citizens, enlightened citizens, who took on the whole field of technical education when it maybe didn't have quite the status which it now is beginning to enjoy. But Victoria did lead the way. It concentrated a great deal on technical education, and it reached a very high standard. Indeed, at one time we appeared to be supplying just about all the engineering diplomates for the whole of Australia. And we do have a fine record. But of course, in recent years, that role and the importance of technology is being recognised, and the facilities enlarged in a quite dramatic way. And it's a great pleasure for us all to be here to see concrete, so to speak, concrete evidence of it in this new building. It's important that such badges as society gives to achievement should not be confined to people who have some aptitude in the academic field, that we should equally recognize the importance of skill and outstanding performance and abilities and qualities in technology too. And that's why I am delighted to see the development of degree courses and the recognition that degrees somehow seem to give to people in this field as well. Now we're seeing expansion, improvement. We're seeing buildings and equipment which fully recognize that principle, and I think we all welcome it. Of course, this is only just part of what the council of this college has in mind. As the principal indicated, we had a quick look at this model out here, and he pointed to a small section of what's ultimately proposed and said, well, that's it, that's the Phillip Law Building. And of course, in the context of the whole thing, it is relatively small. It's really a mere component in a vast expansion which eventually will be linked by a first floor concourse, which I take is this one outside, over the entire campus. And then will be a population eventually of some 7,000 to 8,000 students and staff, and they'll be separated in a quite novel and I think highly acceptable way from the vehicle traffic down below. Now, this is a really exciting concept, and it's a great pleasure to see the first bit of it right here outside. The building, though, becomes highly significant as the completion of stage two of the campus plan for the Institute's development as a multidisciplinary centre in advanced education. The first stage, as you recall, was completed in 1974 and was named after Mr. K.H. Boycott, former president of the council and a man who was instrumental in preparing the master plan that I've been talking about. The building, that one over there, contains a library, staff of the School of Business, lecture theatres, classrooms, the cafeteria and administration. But eventually, and it seems unbelievable almost, it will be almost entirely, I understand, a library. And a library is the essential element in any education establishment. Without a library, you haven't got the very centre and heart of learning, of the wisdom of the ages set out in book form. And I'm delighted to know that this institute will eventually have that fine building principally as a library. And the second stage is this building, which is to house, I understand, some branches of the schools of engineering and general studies. Engineering, as we can see in this little booklet, it will bring together as a single unit for the very first time the laboratories and staff of the Department of Civil Engineering, which until now has been scattered over the campus, and similarly the machines and communication sections of the Department of Electrical, and electronic engineering, which have been in two widely separated areas, and they'll be brought here together. The building will also provide a significantly larger area for engineering materials, part of the mechanical engineering department, and so will make possible more developments and accommodate more students. So that's the engineering side. And then in general studies, relocation here will enable the departments of applied psychology and applied sociology to conduct practical training and interviewing, which they find at least some difficulty doing now. And the well-equipped laboratories, the better facilities, must give psychology and sociology students a far better grasp of the experimental nature of the subjects they're studying. Probably the most obvious advantages of all will be in arts and design. The areas of courses being transferred to this building will enable practical training to be increased. In ceramics, for instance, new kiln areas will allow for expansion into architectural ceramics. Graphic design will benefit from improved technical facilities, such as increased studio space. All in all, then, Mr. President, for 5.8 million, you seem to have your money's worth. I won't say a bargain because nothing is ever a bargain, but certainly you have your money's worth. Well then, why call it the Phillip Law Building? It's a bit late not to call it that because it's there in large letters on the outside, but I don't think anyone here would dispute Dr. Phillip Law's leadership in adventure, in discovery, in learning. And that's not a bad start. He's probably most widely known as leader of the Australian National Antarctic Research Expedition and as director of the Antarctic Division of the Department of External Affairs from 1949 to 1966, half a lifetime. He led expeditions that set up Australian stations at Mawson and Davis and took over the United States station at Wilkes. Since 1966, he's been chairman of the Australian National Committee for Antarctic Research. And I suppose he knows more about the Antarctic, its ways and its demeanours and its viciousness times than any other Australian. He holds many other offices, of course, which reflect his strong interest in higher education and research. He's a trustee of the Science Museum of Victoria. He's a member of the Committee for National Sciences of the Australian National Commission for UNESCO, a member of the Forum of Science and Technology of the Australian Academy of Science, and president of the Graduate Union of the University of Melbourne, and many more things as well. But what's endeared in particularly to this institute, and I don't say that they have any ulterior motive in this, but they are impressed by this, that he was a foundation member, really, of the Victorian Institute of Colleges. He had a lot to do with its foundation. And now, and since 1966, his service as vice president, that is the chief executive officer of the Victorian Institute of Colleges, and his commitment to the maintenance and improvement of academic standards in the 15 colleges which are affiliated to it. That, as I say, has endeared him to the College Council, and they no doubt hope that he will see fit to endear himself again in the future, financially. In the face of that, we can all agree that the Phillip Law Building is well named, and I have very much pleasure now in officially declaring it open.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the formal part of this afternoon's celebration, to use the President's word. I do again invite you to walk around the building. You will find... I'm sorry, I'm out of order. Dr. Brodribb. I came really to introduce Dr. Brodribb.
He doesn't. want women to have the last word.
She's an ad libber.
We've been through this one before. Mr. Premier, look, I'm sorry. Can I do this? I am nicely brought up. I'm not used to talking to people with my back to them. Mr. Premier, Dr. Law, honoured guests and ladies and gentlemen, I've got the nicest task. I've got to thank you for coming. I've got to thank the Premier for coming and for talking to us, and we know that he's busy. I've got to tell you how thrilled we are with our new building, and I can tell you how thrilled we are that it's going to carry the name of Dr. Law forever and ever. And we really are very happy about it. I also want to reiterate, and probably this is because of my small business background, we don't turn out an end product. We feel that we provide a service for people who come to us, who ask for education, who ask for skills, so that we can fit them for whatever they want to be fitted for, so that they can find niches in their life that they are fitted for. This is why we are happy that we've got a multi-level and multidiscipline college, and we hope that we can keep it that way. There's another very pleasant task for me. I'm sorry that Mrs. Hamer wasn't able to be present. We've got a little present for her. Hope I don't drop it. It's a plaque, sir. And would you please present that to your wife from us? May I give that back to you? It was made by a member of staff. I'm sorry, I have to look up the name. The potter was Paul Davis, who is a member of staff here. I also have another very pleasant task, and that is to present a small gift to Mrs. Law. Here, have a look, it's a beautiful bowl. This was also made by a member of staff. The vase was made by Joseph Shearer, a member of staff born in Hungary. I have nothing further to say, sir, except to thank you all again and to thank you in particular. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, quite unexpectedly this afternoon, I've met what to me is a unique person. Dr. Brodribb, I just inquired because she mentioned small business. She's a PhD in small business, is that right? Business administration, never mind, near enough. Anyway, I haven't met one before, so that I'm delighted to have that unique experience. I'm even more delighted, of course, to have that beautiful piece of pottery. I'd like to thank Mr. Davis, if he's here, for making it, and if I don't have the chance, I hope I will, and to say that one doesn't need any sort of present when you see a beautiful building like this on display, but it is certainly and will be a reminder to me of a very happy occasion for technical education in Victoria, today's event. Thank you.
Now it really is my turn. I'm so sorry. Dr. Brodribb, as the Premier said, has a PhD in business administration. She is small. She is delightful. She excuses my mistakes. Now, I will say what I was going to say before, which is that the building is open to you. There are some displays of laboratories in laboratories that you might like to look at. I think they're on the next level up. There is some artwork, some of it's displayed around the walls here, some of it in other passages. You'll find there are some cases of some ceramic work. I had a quick look at it this morning. I think it's delightful. I hope you'll have a look at it too. And now we are about to go to afternoon tea. You are welcome to join us. Now, to get to afternoon tea, you go across the walkway, through the doorway, not into the bookshop, but the one round about the middle of the building, down and to your right, level below this right-hand corner. We'll see you there. Thanks very much for coming.